For those I don't know, my name is Larry Malone, and I teach in the Economics Department. And on behalf of the Department of Economics and Management and the Humanities and Management Institute, I'd like to thank you all for attending. I know it's a bit of a strange time, but it's also a nice time of the day. Let me just say that it's a pleasure to introduce you to the person who's had the most significant impact on my own teaching and scholarship. Many of you may know the brilliance of his writings, which really rests in how one can understand so much about economics if one actually knows little of economics when you start. But in observing him in the classroom, I've also learned that at times, the best approach to teaching is to actually say little or nothing. And so today, I think it's in my best interest if I pursue my own silence and ask you to give a warm Hartwick welcome to Dr. Robert Heilbroner.
Thank you all very much. And thank you, Larry. I come up here from New York to see if the world looks the same from Oneonta as it does from New York, or vice versa. Larry originally asked me to speak either on general equilibrium theory or Pareto optimality. I said they're too exciting for a general audience. And I thought instead I would like to talk very personally about why I feel so bad these days and see if why I feel so bad these days is echoed in your own hearts or is just a peculiar ailment that afflicts people who live in New York City where things are very bad indeed. I was thinking about why I feel so bad these days. In fact, the idea became riveted in me this fall when I was abroad. I was in Czechoslovakia, and somebody actually said to me the following line, which I've since seen printed, so like all of the wonderful bon mots, it's in the air. Maybe it hasn't reached you, I don't know. He said to me, truthfully, last year, he was speaking in 1990, so I meant 1989. It was the year when the wall came down. Last year was the year of the light at the end of the tunnel, and this year is the year of the tunnel at the end of the light. That struck me as, God, absolutely right, because I had been feeling for some time that I was in a kind of a tunnel. But as is often the case, the words gave sort of concreteness to the idea. And I've been thinking, that image of the tunnel has been with me ever since. And I have been thinking seriously about why it is I feel so bad and why it is I feel so much that I am in a kind of a tunnel. That is to say, a long, dark place that doesn't have easy exits and in which one doesn't quite know how to which one doesn't any longer quite know which way is north, which way is south, east and west. Just to put that question into context and to narrow it down, I have thought maybe it's just come upon me, this feeling, really quite rapidly since the whole Iraqi involvement. Because we all have had a tremendous sense of come down. I mean, whether you were for the war or against the war, it was irresistible, this TV war with this marvelous cleanliness and missiles that went around corners and entered chimneys, smokestacks, and all the rest, and nobody getting killed, and technology everywhere. And it hasn't been until recently that, in the first place, the dreadfulness of the slaughter has come home, or begun to come home, 100,000 people dead. And in the second place, the whole, in a manner of speaking, pointlessness of the endeavor. It was a wonderfully carried out maneuver. It did secure for us what we at the time thought was all we need secured, but now we find that we have gone through it and things are, as it were, back to where they were. In the first place, we stand the risk of becoming a sort of target of Arab animosity, which perhaps we did anyway, and nothing seems to be resolved. And the same considerations come to me when I broaden the focus or the search for why I have this malaise away from Iraq, which is certainly not the real cause of it, to the feelings that were in me when this man from Czechoslovakia said the wonderful remark about the tunnel. It is the fact that, like everybody else, I'd lived in the grip of the Cold War, which seemed to me to orient everything I thought about. When I talk about international economics, international politics, there was the Cold War, the great fact. And in some manner of speaking, we all wanted the Cold War to come to an end, and we all wanted the edifice of communism, whose realities have become increasingly clear, to lose. So it lost. And there was a tremendous moment of euphoria, rather like the time when we, not so far ago, when we quickly won the war. When the wall came down and the Soviet Union came down, everything came down all at once, and the Velvet Revolution took place, and we went around for a long time saying capitalism has won, socialism has lost. I wrote a couple of articles on capitalism has won, socialism has lost. and felt that a great moment of clarification had arrived in history. We now knew what side was what, but that too seems to have come apart. Indeed, we won the Cold War, but we seem to be going in just as much of a state of confusion as we were before. The Soviet Union is no longer communist, but God knows what it is today, including whether it's Soviet or a union. The Eastern European countries don't know which way they're going, and we very much fear that, that whichever way they do go, it will not be easy. And one has the sense that there, too, the triumph of a moment has been passed, leaving us with a large sense of disorder. And that also raises in my mind, I think many people's minds, the question of what is it about these times in which we live that is so dispiriting? Because I guess dispirit is the spirit that's in the air. But I don't think in all truth that that's the full reason either. I mean, we are experiencing the unpleasant awareness that after the Cold War was over, another kind of more deeply smoldering war continues. It must have been there all the time. It just masked from view. I mean, Czech versus Slovak and all the various names in Yugoslavia, Serbs and Croats and the nationalities inside the Soviet Union, and of course the Irish against the Irish and the Arabs against the Jews. Those deep ethnic hatreds continue. In Poland, I'm told, having gone through its miseries and horrors, you now find spray-painted slogans and swastikas on the wall saying, "Jews, get out." So one says to oneself, is the net effect of all that excitement, that much celebrated victory in Europe, been nothing but a kind of return to 1914? God save us. That's really a tunnel at the end of the light, isn't it? But I don't think even that is really why I feel bad. That's chastening, but doesn't make me feel so oppressed as I do these days. I think the oppression comes when I turn back to this country. Because I do feel, certainly in New York, for reasons I'll mention in a second, but for the country as a whole, if I could talk about myself as a citizen of the United States, I feel that bad as things are in Europe, and terrible as they are in the Soviet Union and all the rest, what is happening in the United States is, for some reason or other, peculiarly upsetting, perhaps because I am an American, but perhaps because America has always stood in the world's eyes for something that out in the forefront of the West. But that's not exactly what I think we see today. I suspect the aspect of the United States that makes me most personally miserable, something that I see with my own eyes and talking to Larry and John Nader, perhaps one can even see in Oneonta, and that's homelessness. I live 3 or 4 subway blocks from where I teach at the new school. I make this short 20-minute trip a couple of times a week. I was just mentioning to my friends, I pass about 12 examples of Les Miserables in their 12 appointed places. People get their little slots. And you go downtown, there's this particular miserable person, that particular miserable person, and you don't know what to do. I can't afford to give a dollar to all the 12. That's $12 going down, $12 coming back home. 3 times a week, you can't do that. And if you only give $1, you've closed your heart. That's not right. So you don't know what to do. You simply don't know what to do. You look aside, you look away, you put on a studiously indifferent mask. And at the end of each trip, I feel bad. And at the end of now many, many trips, I feel personally affronted by being made to feel bad by people I haven't done any harm to. And I think that general sense of being affronted, I am now angry at them for having put me on the spot. I think many people feel that way. And one of the terrible effects of homelessness and misery that's rubbed in one's faces is that one loses one's sense of moral placement, and you begin sooner or later to resent the misfortune that's been thrust under your nose. And of course, homelessness is only a small part of it. I think at a larger scale about what is going on in the United States in more important ways. I know some records that we hold, for example, which instead of making me proud, make me unhappy. We have the record for having the largest percentage of the population in jail of any Western nation, with even including South Africa. And we have also the record of having the largest number of guns per capita. And we also have the record of the highest number of crimes per capita. Could there be some correlation? And we have the record of in the West, of the highest level of functional illiteracy, and the record of the lowest level of educational achievement among college people. Those are stunning. That's a stunning array of records, all of which also makes one feel, as the homelessness question makes one feel, that something is going on that is dispiriting and discouraging and that makes a mockery of all those triumphs that we had. The Iraq War, certainly, the great triumph of capitalism over communism, equally certainly, and makes me feel that I am somehow in a tunnel. I feel that I live in a country in which social goings-on close to me and distant from me have somehow come out of control. It's a feeling I never really had before. I've certainly had feelings in the time when I've lamented the control they're under, and I've had other feelings, particularly when I was younger, when I had the sense that they were in control and by and large in the control of people with whom I identified and liked. I'm thinking back in the 30s, the New Deal. And I had the feeling that America was on the way, and there was a, far from being in a tunnel, we had come out of a tunnel and we're moving into the light like at the end of a movie picture. Well, I don't feel that anymore. I feel, on the contrary, that there is a certain oppressive darkness around me, and I don't know which way to look for light. I don't know, that's just by way of opening my remarks. I don't really know whether this sense I have is present in Oneonta as much as New York. I don't think it can be quite as much. I mean, cities are very gloomy places. It's much gloomier than this wonderful countryside. And when New York City in particular, which seems to be sinking beneath the waves as I speak, is a very gloomy place. And when I read now about these high-level conferences going on at the mayor's house about when they're going to throw out 37,000 people from city jobs, I remember in the old days, I mean, in the Great Depression, and when the New Deal was beginning, when indeed cities were on hard times, which they often were, somebody in Washington knew what to do, which was to rev up the public works program so that at least some of the people who were displaced from city payrolls could find a place on public payrolls. That you could never do today. I mean, public works, God forbid. I mean, the national debt is high enough already. No, we can't do that. So that the city ailments come with a sense of absence of redress that I never felt before. And I suspect it is more onerous for somebody like myself who's in the city than for somebody like yourselves who reads about the city with a comfortable sense that, thank God, you don't live there. If you do share with me a sense of involvement and perplexity, you must be as concerned as I am about what the trouble is. And that is a real question. I mean, what I've said by way of a laundry list of ailments is not so difficult to come by. You can read it all over the... It's become popular to say this, and the laundry list can be quite long. When it comes to diagnoses, it's not so simple. And my own diagnosis is very uncertain. I offered here more for something for us to talk about afterwards when you throw questions at me than as something which you should scribble down on notes and frame over the mantelpiece. It's just some thoughts on a very perplexing and difficult question whose answer is very important. The first thing I think of, course, is that the whole damn thing is due to the fact we had Reagan and now the beginning of the Bush administrations. Administrations about which one may think as one wishes, but certainly none of whom could be characterized by their own strong supporters as administrations dedicated to renewing the vitality of social life in America. I don't think one could accuse Mr. Reagan of that or Mr. Bush. They are passive administrations, and passive administrations have allowed things to happen in a way that perhaps active administrations would not. And that is, I think, one piece of the puzzle. I mean, when we're done analyzing how come I'm so dispirited? I mean, one of the reasons that I'm so dispirited is because I just can't stand Reagan's administration, or the ex-Reagan administration. Perhaps you don't feel that way. But one part of the answer has to be the pall that the Reagan administration, in particular the Bush administration, less but also noticeably, have thrown over the capacity of the country to become indignant, to take remedial action, to do something. But it's not the whole thing. Can't be the whole thing. I mean, that may be, after my very idiosyncratic appraisal of Mr. Reagan, maybe I shouldn't say that on a college campus, but it is, after all, the fact that the great majority of American people voted for Mr. Reagan and have endorsed Mr. Bush wholeheartedly. So if indeed, to the extent that Reagan himself, in his attitude about these problems, and President Bush, in his attitude, to the extent that they were responsible for, let's say, nipping in the bud what might otherwise have been remedial activities. They were surely supported in this by the great majority of people who voted. So it can be at best a contributory element. It can't really be at the center of the thing. So then I ask myself what perhaps could be another reason. And because I'm an economist, I come to the answer, well, it must be something to do with capitalism. I've been a student of capitalism all my life, and it's a fascinating and deep and very perplexing system. The words immediately label one as being somehow suspect. If I said free enterprise system, that'd be all right. But capitalism is already evidence of the fact that I'm going to say terrible things about it. But I have been interested in capitalism, about which I've said terrible things and good things and puzzle things and other things. And I do think that when you have a condition of widespread systemic dysfunction, which we do, I mean, those things on my laundry list are symptoms, ailments of some deep disorder. You cannot simply ignore the connection between the disease and the host in whose body the disease is manifest. There must be some relation. There must be some affinity between the disorder itself and the larger social entity in which it arises. But having said that, it seems to me I really haven't said very much. I'm particularly chastened about laying too much of a trip on this thing called capitalism, because I'm very interested not just in American capitalism, but in Swedish and German and Dutch and Swiss and Japanese capitalisms. And when I look abroad, when I look generally around the world of capitalisms, I find to my pleasure and dismay that many of the American symptoms are not there at all. And those that are there in much less degree. I mean, there are homeless people in Stockholm, but they're not like they are in New York. Not so many, and not so ignored. Those countries, speaking in general about European Community or Japan, do not stand by idly while their achievement scores go down in college tests, and they do not suffer from widespread adult functional illiteracy. Those countries in general do not suffer from the plight, the condition of urban disarray that affronts my eyes in New York, and I know in many other cities. So I know that something about the condition of life that I find so disturbing in the United States can be discovered perhaps in some small degree everywhere, but only to a small degree. Other parts, not at all. And it gives, at least that tells me that although capitalism may be in some sense involved in this problem, it has to be American capitalism in particular, not just capitalism in general. All of which drives me in a direction I think perhaps we all get turned to it after a while. Whatever the reason is for this condition that upsets me, and I perhaps you also, it has its roots in America. It has its roots in something about the American experience. There may be American capitalism. I mean, capitalism may be still in there. It is, after all, a system that devotes its attention to making money, not first to taking care of people. That's not at the top of the agenda. But there's something in the American style that is, I think, the most culpable when we look for candidates, reasons, explanations for why things are where they are. So I shall now try to find some things specifically American that I think lie at the root of the problem. Well, the first thing I think of, because it comes through in economic history, which I've done some work, is this much quoted expression called American exceptionalism. American exceptionalism means that America had a different historical background from Europe. Indeed it did. We were born free, so to speak. We sprang from the brow of freedom like Minerva from Jove's brow, whatever it is. I mean, we just began without a feudal past. When the pilgrims came over and set up in their wonderful colonies in the early 18th century, 17th century. But American exceptionalism has made us, in some very deep ways, unlike Europe. I don't really know if there's such a thing as collective memory. But somehow or other, buildings have memory. America didn't have buildings to remind itself of the hand, of the ancient hand of kings, or the church, or the discouragements of perished civilizations. We began scot-free, so to speak. America was, as they say, born free. And that born freedom has, of course, been a tremendous source of American vitality. But it occurs to me, I'm certainly not the first person whom it has occurred, that born freedom has also brought to America an absence of kind of sense of social responsibility that other, quote, older civilizations may have. And there are other aspects of the American exceptionalism. America is very big, and most of these countries in Europe are not so big. So there's something about bigness that lends itself to indifference, and something about smallness that lends itself to communitarian feelings, and maybe that has a piece of it, and maybe it does. and then pursuing American exceptionalism. America has always been, and has prided itself on being a land of many religions, types, and so on. I mean, I wouldn't say prided itself on being multiracial, because it hasn't prided itself on that, although it has been multiracial. Whereas the successful capitalisms abroad, everybody's blonde. I was in Sweden a couple of years ago. Amazing. There are fewer people in Sweden than there are in New York City. Everybody is blonde, and everybody seems to be called Johansson, something like Johansson. And so when something goes wrong, the Swedes worry about themselves in the way that I wish Americans worried about themselves. Every time something goes wrong, everybody has a cousin, a second cousin, who is touched by this. So the Swedish family rallies around, and one can do amazing things with a small country, very much aware of its common unities, that I think one has much greater trouble affecting in a large country like ourselves, where these shared kinship bonds are missing. But that too, you know, it doesn't strike me as being enough to answer the question about why America seems to be so much in the rear of social behavior these days, as I see it. One reason why I don't wish to put it forward, because there's nothing we can do about that. We can't change America. We can't take away American history. We can't suddenly load on a medieval history and give us social conscience at the same time. There's no way of making America smaller, and there's no way of making ourselves more homogeneous, more, so to speak, blonde. So however important those factors may be, there's no use placing them at the center, because they are givens, irremediable. And I don't think that they are sufficient in themselves to account for the whole thing. So I go a little further and begin to come to what I think is the core of the issue. And I think I shall be perfectly blunt about it. I think the core of the issue lies in the fact that America has no political life. It has a lot of political activity, has political parties, a lot of political talk, much political rhetoric, huge amount of political piety, but no political life. When I say political life, I mean there is not in America, as I see it, any active, open, unafraid public confrontation, presentation to ordinary people of the facts I've been talking about. There has been no consideration as to whether, or to what extent, capitalism in America may bear some share of the blame for the way things are misfunctioning. There isn't even any talk about American exceptionalism. There's very little talk at all, except a certain amount of tongue clucking and a certain amount of pious promises from the Bush administration that these problems are very serious and must be addressed. Nothing then seems to follow. There's no political life. When I say no political life, I mean there's no real part of the opposition. There's no real party of the opposition. There are no Greens, there are no Social Democrats, God knows there are no Socialists, no Laborites. I mean, there's just Republicans, whether they're called Republicans or Democrats, is just really one spectrum, a party with a spectrum, a party with a spectrum. Of course, there's a big difference between being a conservative Republican and being a liberal New Dealer. But the difference isn't big enough. The difference isn't big enough so that embarrassing and awkward questions can be asked, which, if they were asked within the context of our present political array, would appear to be heretical, even perhaps, what should I say, bordering on the, God forbid, traitorous. It's that fact, I think, that really distinguishes the United States. Every country in the world that I can think of has a party of the opposition. They have Greens and Social Democrats and Socialists. The only party of the opposition I can think of here are the fundamentalists, and they're not, thank God, a political party. We really do not have a party of the opposition which brings into ordinary American discourse some consideration of alternatives. These alternatives may be utterly ignored. I mean, in Great Britain, for example, there's a party of the opposition, it's the Labour Party. It's been ignored for a long time now. People just did not want to buy its program, perhaps because the program wasn't very good. But at least it existed, it spoke out, it didn't call back, it didn't recoil from calling a spade a spade. And God knows there are such parties in Japan, in Germany, in France, in Italy, in every Scandinavian country and so forth. We alone do not have it. I think that if America is to come back into the land of the living, out of the land of the zombies, which I think is where we now reside, it will have to develop a political party. I don't see any reason to believe that out of the present workings of what we call the political system, there will arise the determination to carry through programs of change. it isn't that one can't imagine such programs. I mean, it's not beyond the wit of man to think of how to put people who are out of work to work, for example, by fixing the roads or building infrastructure and so on. I mean, it's not beyond our wit either how to educate people, particularly people who don't get any education at all. You build the schools and you send them to it. And isn't out of imagination how to take care of the worst poverty? You arrange for welfare payments. I mean, you do the things that are done around the world, and you will make inroads in the problems we have. It is possible to control small arms among the population. It is possible to do all sorts of things. But I don't think it's apt to be done until some party of the opposition emerges. It may only be a party of the opposition. It may never be a party of the majority. Somebody has to present an agenda for change with sufficient cogency and sufficient repetitiveness so that eventually perhaps some part of it enters into the working imagination of people. Right now it's very hard to imagine such a party at all. I mean, it's hard enough, God knows, when a few liberal people like Governor Florio or Governor Weicker timidly introduce a tax program and they get themselves clobbered the next day. So it won't be easy. Just the same, the idea of a party of the opposition strikes me as essential because it is missing in this country. Now comes the last and worst part of what I want to say, and that is, usually when you make a talk like this, you announce the problem, you analyze the problem, and then you give a solution, you know? And you leave with three ringing points. One must do A, B, and C. I leave with no ringing points. The reason I like the tunnel analogy, I think, is that I feel I'm in a tunnel. I don't see any immediate, quick, easy way out. I hearken back to my early days. I hearken back, I hope for a renewal of what I call the New Deal, those sentiments. I want to see American capitalism placed on the track of reform capitalism, as indeed the New Deal did, and as indeed all the opposition parties in Europe have done. I want to see reform capitalism take the place of contemporary capitalism, and that will need a new political party. Let's call it a new New Deal. But when I say that, I must quickly confess that I don't really see the makings of a new New Deal. I don't see labor taking an active part, not given what has happened to labor organization and labor mentality as it is today. I don't see an elite of far-sighted businessmen taking the lead that they did in the 1930s in restructuring American corporate life. I don't see an aroused middle class, yes, middle class, once again, making evident its moral indignation about the state of things, as indeed was the case when I grew up and had my first taste of politics in the late 1930s. So I don't see any easily available gallery out of the tunnel up to the light. If I did, I would quickly tell you what it was. I would tell you what we should do. I would community action, what we should do collectively in order to get the new deal going, but I don't see it. So I'm unhappy being in the darkness of the tunnel and not seeing a gallery and not being able to tell you or myself what to do. The other possible gallery I've always thought, used to think, was that, well, one could strike off in a bolder way. One could say, oh, the system just isn't working well enough. Let's design another system. I was like, even in the imagination. One of the less happy consequences of the end of the Cold War is that the social imagination has become constrained. It's very hard to imagine a system beyond capitalism. By capitalism, I now mean Sweden, with quotes on it, imaginary Sweden, not real Sweden. Real Sweden has lots of problems, but imaginary Sweden has less problems. It's very hard to imagine a social system beyond Sweden. Sweden works very good, and imaginary Sweden works even better. And imaginary Sweden not only works better in the sense of resolving the problems I've talked about well enough, don't have to be perfect, but it's still capitalist. It's not some kind of departure from what I call capitalism. Private enterprise, the market, the public sphere, and the private sphere, and all the rest. It's a very, very reformed capitalism. So it's very hard to imagine the other gallery, the other hidden tunnel out of the tunnel, which would be sort of making the leapfrog out of capitalism to something else. Right now, there is no something else. And I suspect for a very long time, there will not be a something else. So then the question is, what do we do here in the tunnel? And that's where my talk's going to end, because I don't know. If I were talking to you in Europe, I would say, that's how it is in America, folks, but thank God we're out of the tunnel. I'm talking to you in America, and I'm saying to you, we have to get out of the tunnel, we have to find a way out, but as of right now, I don't see a way out. And that's the end of this very dispiriting talk. Thank you. told Larry I'd be very happy to answer questions, unless they're too painful, and I will. So why don't you just let fly, and I will answer as best I can. Yeah.
Are there any grassroots organizations currently trying to introduce the green parties and social democrats into the system?
There are, of course, reform groups. I mean, ranging from, it's very hard to sort of place people on the spectrum anymore. There is a social democratic party, Mike Harrington's old quote party group, to which I maintain a sort of sentimental connection, but it's not very effective, and I think it has a zero effectiveness. There are people who feel, as I do, and perhaps as you do, that something ought to be done, but there is not a framework yet to do it. These things arise spontaneously, I think, in all truth. It's awfully hard to set out to do something when you don't quite know how to do it. Perhaps, I hope, since I do not believe this is the end of history, I hope that who knows what, out of community groups, out of labor unions, out of ecological groups, there will yet emerge something which strikes a spark. And the next thing you know, we're off into the races. Maybe there'll be a Greens here. Maybe there'll be a Social Democratic. But I don't really know at the moment what structure there is for me to throw my lot in with. If I did know, I'd be here to tell you about it. Please.
I agree with you in your analysis of political life in the United States. Again, the conventional wisdom is that, for example, Democrats are advised to become more like Republicans if they want to win the White House. And we all know that most politicians are intimidated by the present status quo. It's hard, even, you know, in my short lifespan, I've seen even a newspaper like the New York Times become more and more unable to express a full view on any issue. So I wish you'd comment a little more on that, since the conventional wisdom is going just the opposite way. If Democrats want to maintain power, they're going to have to be more like Republicans. Yeah. And you're suggesting that this is going to do away with political, or this undercuts political one.
Well, you've said it very well, and you've certainly expressed either what I said or what I felt. What you've said very well is, once again, to describe the tunnel. The nature of the tunnel is that, indeed, the very things I would like us to do, taking on myself the role of being some sort of pundit about what should be done, the very things that I would like to see us do are indeed things which may worsen the inertia. Indeed, the conventional wisdom tells Democrats, and probably rightly, how do I know, that they should be more like Republicans. And hence we have a compression of the political spectrum rather than an enlargement of the political spectrum. Maybe what you said is also to articulate with different words my own sense of bewilderment about what to do next. Because if I went and I advised my favorite Democratic candidates, go thou and be different, it's consigning them to oblivion. And perhaps it's another way of saying that is that my inarticulateness, my inability to tell you what I think should be done, measures the complexity of the situation. I feel it's like waiting for Godot. We are waiting for a resolution of this problem. If there is no resolution, and if, God forbid, my analysis is right, we will stay in the tunnel for a long time. And America will go on, and it will have a great deal of social dysfunction. And Europeans will come here and cluck their tongues. And they'll say, oh, it's incredible about America. Never mind what's happening to the economy. Maybe that'll be wonderful. I've no idea. But they'll say, it's perfect, you just can't go to New York anymore, it's so dangerous. Or you can't talk to an American these days without the American telling you how terrible things are back home in his city. That would be unhappy. I would like to see America become, 20 years from now, on a par with Switzerland. You know, go for a walk at night. But to do that, we have to break out of this self-reinforcing dilemma, do we not? And I do not know how to do it. So I repeat, I lay my faith, I see two options. One is we don't do a thing, and the dilemma continues. Who knows, in the end, social dynamics have their own strange way. God knows what. We could be worse, you know. Or some looked for, hoped for answer will arise, a messiah, in the name of some political group that finds the answer and that rekindles American life. Because I do remember the New Deal days, I still believe there's a great deal of the ingredients of reform capitalism in America, namely indignation, a strong sense of right and wrong, a feeling of essential moderation. Things shouldn't be too wonderful when you're on top and too terrible when you're on the bottom. A certain pragmatism about things and so on. So it seems to me the ingredients are there. I don't believe we're a nation of economic fundamentalists, but I really don't know what to do about it.
Can I say just one thing?
Please.
Summarizing what I think you say, is that what convention thinks is the solution to the problem, you define as the problem.
Yeah, it's good. Yes.
In the same vein, you may have seen, it seems to me that Russell Baker last week drew an analogy very similar to yours, referring to the Democratic Party as a dead brain society. His analogy that he suggested that I'd be interested in your comment on was that what the Democrats need now is a Goldwater, somebody who is prepared to speak to the faithful, even if it means electoral disaster, on the grounds that only by once again energizing the faithful is there a possibility of really doing something on the longer range.
I hadn't seen that Russell Baker thing. I must, if you'll forgive me for telling you a crack. So Russell Baker had a wonderful, his second book, some book, I think a book of the best Baker columns. And someone asked me to write a blurb for it. I wrote the following blurb, as I remember it. Something like, Russell Baker is a national treasure. This is the sort of remark that Mr. Baker likes to turn over to find stamped on it, made in Hong Kong. Yes, that's a wonderful Bakerism, and it's in its way it's true. We need someone who is willing to try to rekindle these ideas at because he or she deeply believes in them, even at the cost of personal disavowal by the electorate. And the Democratic Goldwater may be the answer. Yes, please. I'll take a stab at that. My sense is that economic growth and social morale are not as closely linked as we sometimes think. That is to say, economic growth feeds the fortunes of very important institutions called corporations and very important groups of the population, middle level management, top management, skilled labor technicians, and so forth. I don't think that economic growth automatically feeds the morale deficient part of the population, the black and the poor. That, I think, requires intervention. I suspect it requires federal intervention on a fairly sustained scale. So I think that the growth is a very important overall ingredient for the upper two-thirds of the country, but not so important for the lower one-third. And in Germany, I think, they're now talking about two-level society. Germany has this problem too, though not nearly so exacerbated as we. They have the upper level society, which rides along with the momentum of the great machine. I mean the great economic machine. And the lower level, the lower tier, semi-marginalized, which somehow has become decoupled from the great engine and is left behind. That would be my own feeling.
It's been said that part of our problem with our political, or our dysfunction, is caused by the fact that Americans don't work as hard as our foreign
I really don't know. I've heard so many stories about that. I heard another story, too, that when British and German, I don't know about German, take that back, British and some other group, French, workers come over here, they take one look at American factories and say, my God, don't even work that hard. I think Americans have a fast work pace. I don't really know. So I really don't know. That's just an anecdote, which is never an answer. Yeah.
I think that actually there were three wars. You talked about the Cold War, which we won. We won the war against Iraq, but we lost the war on poverty. Mm. And I think Americans genuinely believe that. And that means that liberalism died with that. And I think what it also did is to reinforce winter tunnel. And it's one of the things that we think is our greatest strength and our greatest virtue, and that is the emphasis on individualism. And what have you commented on?
I think that's well said, what you just said. I do think that Americans feel that we have, quote, waged the war against poverty and lost it. And hence it was a bad, it was like Vietnam. We should have never done it in the first place. To which the answer is, we began to wage it. We had quite a considerable success in cutting almost in half the, quote, officially measured, you know, below the official poverty. And then starting in the sort of middle of the Reagan regime, essentially tax changes and changes, the administrative provisions of aid for dependent children, all those welfare organizations. It's hard to say the word I'm about to say, but I would say deliberately cut down the flow of sustaining expenditures to the most marginalized groups, and poverty began to worsen. I'm not a quote poverty expert, so I can't tell you the full story of the dynamics of poverty. But I've been led to believe by the subversive magazines I read that it was not just the invisible hand, but there were some visible hands doing it too. And I think that if you could get the democratic order that we're all looking for now to get up and say these things, to make public what only readers of the Nation, maybe the New Republic, know, it might make the public realize that the war has not been properly waged, that there might have been a different outcome to it. But the point you make is right, and individualism, of course, lies at the core. That's a hard question to answer, I'll answer it with more of a quip than an answer. Seema Martin Lipset, wrote a book that I think is called Political Man, or maybe it's The First New Nation, some damn book, in which he talked about the contrasting ideologies of two neighboring countries whose great cultural shaping experience was the same, namely an assault on and a conquering of wilderness, Canada and the U.S. And the U.S., out of this experience, somehow found a culture hero for itself, the cowboy, the very essence of the individual. And the Canadians found a hero. It was the Royal Mounted Policeman, rather different. Now, how one accounts for these differences? Maybe they come out of the born free experience, I don't know. It is true that individualism was an enormous ideological source of vigor for us, particularly in the 19th century. And today, perhaps, stands in the way because it has not been reinterpreted in light of the urban and other realities of experience. I can't say much more. Sir, I'm told by Larry that I have to be someplace else in 5 minutes, is that right? So if you don't mind, let's have just 2-3 more questions. Yeah. My honest answer to that very good question is I'm not sure. I mean, the question is a good question. It takes me aback because I don't have a quick and ready answer. It's more of a history in terms of pendulums. And in a manner of speaking, my own half resignation, half messianic faith in the future is pendulum history. I mean, something will come along. We will muddle through yet. But I don't know enough about Whig history. Somebody. You bet. but you're on my right.
Just a few points of clarification.
Yeah.
I think that in rural areas like Oneonta, we feel equally bushed as city people do.
Good.
And that if Larry would take you 5 minutes out of Oneonta in any direction, you'll see the most desperate poverty you would see in Harlem. It's just more invisible in the country. But we have actually a higher rate of poverty in the United States in rural areas than in urban areas.
Just by way of footnote, I'm sure you may well. I suspect that the existential reality of it is less dreadful.
Is less what?
Dreadful. Less dreadful.
It's more isolated.
Yes, but less dreadful.
Perhaps not to the people who live it, but maybe to those of us at Hartwick where we're insulated.
Yeah.
On the second point of clarification, this notion of American exceptionalism, I find this notion that we were born free curious, in that if you look at feudal relationships that exist,
That is absolutely true.
And finally, when you say, do we have voices of dissent and are we organized, I'm less pessimistic than you are about the tunnel. And I do feel there are really strong organized voices of opposition, but I also believe and feel the repression that exists in all the major institutions of society. So one issue that I didn't see mentioned, at least up front in your talk, were institutions of repression that exist in the United States to repress the dissenting voices. In the academy today, I think that those voices of opposition are being controlled in this discussion of political correctness. And the discussion of political correctness is a sign that the mainstream is being confronted and doesn't like it.
Yes? I don't really know what to say. I mean, are there repressive forces in the country? Of course. Are they worse than they were? I don't think so. I don't feel that. I feel that somehow rather the curious nature of changes in this country, class shifts, marginalization, this and that, have taken away the momentum and the self-belief on which dissident movements can find an effective political base. It isn't enough to have a dissident movement. The dissident movement has to find a response. Now, for example, feminism is a very powerful dissident movement. It is not yet a large-scale public reality. Maybe it will be. Maybe, who knows, when I say the parties of the opposition, perhaps the party of women will be the party of the Greens in this country. I don't know. But it is not yet. So then I have to go. Yeah.
The question of a Goldwater for the Democratic Party. We have one, it's Jesse Jackson. And I'm wondering if the situation that we confront is rather a historical and social one that makes it impossible for the spark of Jesse Jackson to ignite any massive social force for a number of reasons that are very different from what we confronted in the 1930s and the 1960s when there was a strong development of reform capitalism within the Democratic Party. First of all, the poor don't vote. They're discouraged for whatever reason, probably very rational reason, they don't buy it. Secondly, the labor unions are terribly weak now in a way that was not the case when they were rising in the 30s and when they were very powerful in the 60s. There's no such social base within the Democratic Party for a candidate to take the risks that would be required for such leadership. And finally, the enlightened capitalists leave. The capital does not recognize national borders, let alone national responsibility and national character. If there's trouble at home, they just decamp. They move their operations, and now even their headquarters, as Robert Wright pointed out in a recent article, it's, you can't even say that the headquarters are at home. Any effort of would-be reform Democrats to sort of sink their hands into this bastion of economic power is greatly undermined by the mobility of capital.
I
wonder if you're not being too optimistic.
I'm skeptical about whether the mobility of capital plays a significant role in the failure of a business elite to assert itself in concert with, it's not going to be the leadership, in concert with us. I doubt it. That's all I can say. The other more interesting question is Jesse Jackson, and I'll give you my candid answer. My feeling is that this movement, if and when it comes, probably cannot be led by somebody who's black. There's just too goddamn much there to be overcome, to expect that. There's too much difficulty anyway in finding a new agenda, which will cause people to rethink many cherished values. Too much to expect that it's likely to be led by a black. Now, who knows? I mean, these elements of charisma are so personal, so idiosyncratic. It could just be that Jesse Jackson doesn't have what it needs to come across with transcendent power to anybody, of black, white, or what have you. But I think he doesn't, and his appeal is within the black community, not beyond the black community. Maybe the next person will, who knows what, do that. Now, you all forgive me, and thank you for being so.